Have you guys ever wondered what a restoration project on a bur oak savanna looks like? Well, today we're going to walk you through the steps of an amazing transformation on this 27 acres in northeast Nebraska. All right, we're standing on the edge of the property where the savanna restoration took place. And this is exactly what the unit looked like prior to the Volkerts, the landowners, really getting after and implementing a habitat management plan and restoring the savanna. So what we're standing in is an overcrowded bur oak stand with a heavy midstory of species like ironwood, elm, and very little herbaceous cover, right? We all know that when we cut trees, we open up the canopy, we're gonna allow sunlight to the forest floor. That's going to change the plant communities that are growing there. Well, here, we don't have that sunlight really reaching the forest floor. We can see that represented whether it's bare or there's very little vegetation growing. Most of the species are broadleafs and woody component. That's what's gonna survive in an area with minimal sunlight, heavy shade, and you're gonna see that plant community represented here. We go across the way, across the ditch, and go to the same exact soil type, the same exact slope exposure, and we're gonna see a whole different type of plant community growing there, all based on sunlight. But it's really important for you guys looking and watching the video to really understand the structure difference between this type of cover and where we're gonna be going to next. You can see it in relation to, let's say, my hips or my mid-torso, where that cover falls at. When most people look at a savanna, they think, wow, that's super wide open. How is that cover? They're gonna think this is cover. In reality, from a deer's perspective, 4.5 foot and down, we're gonna find way more cover, way more deer. We already did this morning out in that savanna, opposed to cover like this that is woody, doesn't get much sunlight. So let's walk across and go make that comparison. All right, guys, well, it's clear we're standing in a completely different section. Look at this vegetation, the heights, the structure, the composition, totally different ball game when we're talking about wildlife usage in this area versus where we came from. But it's important to talk about that transformation. What we're standing in looked just like that 2 years ago. And that was in February of 2020, this site began to change. The landowner and his son came in and hammered out some work, chainsaw, and the biggest piece of equipment that they had was a skid steer to help maneuver some of this brush and push trees down. But we were looking at a mid-story of eastern red cedar, elm, and ironwood, and other bur oaks that just completely dominated this, and again, made it look like where we just came from. But in a matter of 2 years, a lot of hard work, elbow grease, they thinned the forest to the degree that was recommended, and they have then used fire to consume those piles of debris and done an amazing job of opening this back up and restoring that savanna. This is all feasible. Anybody can replicate this. Yes, it's going to take hard work, but these two individuals have a perfect example of what quality habitat restoration projects can yield as your results. Not to mention the number of wild turkeys that are being produced here, harvested here, and the quality of deer that they're seeing, the frequency of deer, amount of daylight activity has drastically increased pre-transformation. So you might be wondering, who does this actually benefit? How is this beneficial to wildlife? So let's talk specifically about deer right away. So obviously this height structure is going to produce cover, both fawning cover, some bedding cover, and through the entire year that's going to change and morph some. But right now it is June. We've had some almost record temperatures in this region. We're talking high 90s, 100 plus, but with this open canopy and the semi-shade areas and the height structure of this vegetation, there's not only forage everywhere, but a breeze can blow through. You see it happening right now. We're actually able to get out of the sun and thermoregulate because of the breeze that's blowing through here and the shade component that the overstory is producing. So not only do we have good cover for the summertime, we also have ample forage everywhere. In addition to that, when we turn into fall, a lot of this vegetation is going to still be standing. And again, we've got other things that are coming on, more woody saplings and other portions and areas that we've cut more of the bur oaks and left them standing, excuse me, left them laying for more structure on the ground. Those areas are going to have more cover, but it's very important to note that although this has a lot of herbaceous cover and forage during the growing season, the mass production in this unit has most likely increased as well. We've removed the stress trees, we've removed the dense competition and the spacing and the resources that each one of these bur oaks need, sunlight, water, root space, the nutrients from the ground. Well, it's being allocated into the trees that are still remaining, therefore making them healthier, producing more mast. So as we roll into fall, the mast production in this unit, although trees have been harvested, will increase over time as these trees are more healthy individuals. So we really cover the year and the basis for what whitetails need. We even jumped some fawns out of here earlier this morning as we were reviewing this site. So every single month there is production, there is value that whitetails can use here. And the amount of daylight occurrence too during hunting season, because of the structure that's in this unit, has increased hunting opportunities as well. So important to note that this is not just a restoration project, this is hunting focused as well. And they've been able to reap the rewards of that. And just the past 2 years, it's only gonna get better as the plant communities in the understory continue to develop. Specifically for wild turkeys, I think there's been 4 nests for sure, that or 4 hens that have nested in here. Don't know the success of them yet, but that's just this growing season so far. So we have nesting cover, we have nesting substrate, and with the different areas and different thinning degrees of the bur oaks, we have some areas that are gonna be pretty optimal for brood rearing cover as well. Actually, the landowner's wife saw turkey and poults in their yard heading this direction earlier today. So this is very productive from a forage standpoint, from a reproduction standpoint, and not to mention during the hunting season for turkeys in the spring, much of this cover is thinner. So birds can roost in these trees if they choose to. They have the ability to fly up opposed to really dense midstories and neighboring properties. But in addition to that, they can strut through here, forage through here without having too much obstruction as they're moving across the landscape. So hens are here frequently, gobblers are here frequently during hunting season. We're making turkeys off this 27 acres annually because of the work that's being done. It's a high quality site for deer and wild turkeys.